Tim started with an introduction, giving some broad overview about Kafka, about mainly about using Kafka for integration into microservices environment, the idea of the commit lug. He already gave some sneak peek into stream processing with Kafka. He showed KSQL and the KStreams API. I would take it then a more and talk about streaming in a more broader context. So what is streaming? Why do we do data streaming? What are challenges in data streaming? And some things that might help to solve them, and also some solutions like frameworks as Kafka Streams, as Spark, as Flink, but also some take a look into the cloud-native solutions of AWS and Google. So if you're already using the cloud, this might be interesting for you. So some ideas, what is streaming, typical problems, some frameworks, then some current innovations, what is going on into streaming right now, what's the topic people working on, the cloud offerings, and some recommendations when thinking about streaming. So the basic ideas of streaming, so dealing with big data. Right now we have a lot of times we have some data coming in, stored somewhere, and then we have some batch processing, the typical night one, where we do the processing of incoming events of the day, do some analytics on this, or some insurance companies like doing the policies, writing policies, and all the stuff is done during the night, written back to the database. Then there might be some visualization of the data or anything like this. And then there's sometimes a so-called speed layer where we just get the data, aggregate the data, store the data somewhere, and get near real-time results. So this is known as batch layer and speed layer, and this architecture is called the Lambda architecture, which is, I think it was like 5, maybe 10 years ago, this term was used in a pretty wide context. But there, the batch layer was mainly there because it always meant that streaming couldn't be exact. Streaming is too slow. It's only an approximate result. We do have a batch layer because we want to have correct results, so we have to run it again and again. But by now, streaming is so good, and the streaming frameworks and the concepts are so good, we can totally rely on streaming for correct results. We don't need this batch processing anymore. So basically, we want to get rid of the batch layer and just process data as it arrives, get the results, and do the analysis. But why is streaming such a big thing right now? Because there are a lot of sources for streaming data, actually. We have the first thing which comes to mind is most of the times all the things in IoT, all the sensor devices which send a lot of data, maybe multiple times a second or multiple times a minute. Then there's a lot of sensors all over again in some, if you think about an industrial complex, if every machine has some sensor, then a huge amount of data arises. But it's not only IoT. IoT is the first thing people think about when we're streaming, but it's also like advertising or clickstream analysis. Like in an online shop, I want to analyze what data is coming in, what people are clicking on, what are not clicking on, and then try to understand why didn't they follow on the next step because they struggled to fill out this text field and do some analysis on this one. Then it's an online gaming, for instance, maybe some of you know, you don't have to admit it, Candy Crush Saga on Facebook, which is, I think it's from King, and King is actually using Flink as a backend to process the events inside the game to enhance what they say, enhance the experience for the player. Basically, they want to promote in-game sales to the player buys the in-game stuff. Then there's the automotive company, which is a result, a part of the IoT company. Self-driving cars is maybe not this use case for streaming because self-driving cars is more like it's not like I collect all the data and analyze it, but it's more like really hard real-time requirements, which is most of the time not true for this one. We have financial transactions. It's not like we're doing the actual transactions, writing the data to some, writing the change of cash or budget, but it's mostly like analysis the financial transactions, find out which might be fraud, which might not be fraud, but it's not in real time. But for all those streaming data sources, it's like the data is endless and continuous. It's not like I have a chunk of data and I want to process this chunk of data, but it's the data keeps on flowing into the system and we still want to analyze it. And we want it in real time or near real time. So we don't talk about hard real time. If you do like an want to control a nuclear plant, that's not going to work with this one, but it's near real time in since like in milliseconds or seconds. And most of the time, because it's a huge amount of data you want to analyze, you do it in a distributed and scalable fashion. So a lot of times it's totally fine to just have one Java application doing this analysis, and most of the time it's easier to use one of the streaming frameworks. But if you want to go distributed and to have larger amounts of data, then these streaming frameworks might help. It's not true for everyone. Kafka Streams is one example where also a small instance might be helpful because it's pretty easy and pretty lightweight, but we will take a look into this later. So what are typical problems if we do this analysis on data? The first thing we have is time. And together with times, the most of the times comes order. So what is the problem with time and order when data is coming into my system? There's a notion of event time and processing time. The event time is the time when the event actually occurs in real life, like let's take a plane ride and I do play some games on maybe Candy Crush on my mobile phone, and then I just have some events, and that's the event time, just when this event happens. In an ideal world, the processing time would be the same as the event time. Processing time means this event is observed by my system and I can work on it and can work with the data. So this would be the ideal case. Most of the time it's not like this, but it's a little bit delayed because of whatever, wiring or what, and so on. A little bit more, or then the next event gets delayed, or we have out of order events, like we have the first event, and then we have another event, and the event at minute 6 is seen at minute 8. So we have an out of order thing here. Example, for instance, is taking this airplane example a little bit further. We have an intercontinental flight, 12 hours flight. Everybody's playing with their smartphones and getting back, landing in the US, and then switching on your mobile phone. There's a lot of data going to be transmitted. It's 12 hours out. Some of the data is 12 hours out. Is it still relevant? When I want to do analysis on the on an hour, maybe 12 hours back, then I have to store the data somewhere. So this is the challenge we have. And the next thing is, it's still an endless stream of data, and it's rather hard to think on endless stream of data. I have to put some more like artificial boundaries on this stream of data. And that's basically what we're doing with windowing. So we slide our stream of data into small chunks we can actually handle and where we can do analysis on this. So a typical example is like 1 hour or 10 minutes or whatever. And all this data is processed as one batch mainly. It's not a batch, but this is seen as one amount of data which I will process together. So there are different size, different ways to do windowing. There's some tumbling window, sliding window, session window. I will come to this on the next slides. And windows don't have to be always on time. They can be on time, and that's actually a pretty common case, but they can also be like on a count, like every 100 events, every 500 events, and they can also be on specific content of an of an event. For instance, think about a web shop. I have a login event and I have a logout event, and I want to analyze all events which have been between the logout and the login event. So this is the tumbling window, which is basically just I take one window and the next window just continues on the next step. We have here 1 second, we have 4 seconds windows. The first window is here, the first 4 seconds, then second 5 to 8 and 9 to 12. We just do a sum on this, on the values. The next thing is the sliding window. We don't move our window by the size of the windows, but only by a fraction of the size. In this case, we use 2 seconds and 4 seconds windows. So we use every 2 seconds, we move our 4 seconds window by 2 seconds. So we have overlapping windows, and this is like giving us a sliding interval, sliding window. If you think about sliding averages and so on, this is can be done with this sliding in windows. So those are the pretty common windows, and then there's also the session window, which can either be based on timeouts or times between events. I want to group events where there's and has been a certain amount of time between two events. Consider the web shop again. We have an 8-hour session timeout. Maybe if there hasn't been an event for about 8 hours, you can be sure the session is over because the session timeout was 8 hours. So this is all there. Those are examples where the time was actually elapsed, but there is a small gap only, and then it's just the lockout event. So you can also combine the windows. It can be based on time and content. It's not an or, it's an and. So, but we were talking about late data again. So this is the data which comes in, and after the time, maybe the time here, there comes another event which actually happened 5 minutes before. So, and by now, that's a delayed event. We have to merge this window because now that's not the time span is not too small. We have to merge those windows again. And this is actually the part you don't want to implement yourself, because that's going to be pretty tricky. And this is things where the streaming frameworks help you. When there's late data, they will manage it for you to fill those windows. One paper which actually discusses in a pretty good way is the data flow model. This is from Google. We can see this later on. It's now in Apache Beam, which is an umbrella project for a streaming API. And data flow is the Google product of streaming. And this is Tyler Akida, which is one of the doing a lot of stuff in the streaming community. And he was one of the main authors of this. And he says, basically, we don't have to treat streaming data as some data set. We can give finite bounds, but we still have to think about, we never know if there's all the data. We only know that there might be new data and that old data may be deleted, retracted, whatever. So don't try to groom those data into finite pools, but always think about new data is coming, there may be late data, and those existing data we have may be changed. And the actually problem is we have to find a balance between correctness, latency, and costs here. You can think of, you can just wait for data forever, maybe like 2 or 3 days, and give the results after 3 days when you think, okay, now every data must be there. Would be definitely correct, or most likely will be correct, but it won't be very efficient in terms of latency, because you have to wait for 2 or 3 days. But most of the time, then the data is obsolete most of the time, and it might be very costly because you have to store and buffer your data, or the data in between somewhere. And the other way around, you can store for one minute only, then you have not that high cost, latency is okay, correctness, yeah, and then, so it's always a trade-off if you deal with streaming data. And the data flow model actually tries to give you some handles to actually decide what is important for me, and that's most of the time not a technical decision, but a business decision. The first thing they introduced were watermarks, which is basically the idea, when am I going to calculate the result of the window. Let's do it with this graph, that's a little bit easier. We have the event time, we have the processing time, and perfectly, if event time is 1, the processing time is 1, the event time is 2, the processing time is 2, and so on. So that would be the ideal world, most of the time won't happen. This is more like what we see in real life. We have event time 1, processing time is already 1.5, or we have 4, and this might be 5 or 6 seconds already elapsed. And this is not like a linear curve, but it's always a little bit like a wave. The first thing we could have done is like, okay, we just process everything 3 seconds later. One thing we could have done. Another way is like, okay, we start with 1 and then just adapt to the, we see the latency of the incoming data, we just try to adapt the our processing. That's then a heuristic way to do this. So the first thing is actually a fixed watermark. Then the watermark just says 3 seconds after the event time passed, I will assume all the data until this event time has been there. So at 10 o'clock and 3 seconds, I assume that all the data which has happened before 10 o'clock has been seen by the system. That's actually what a watermark says. That's the reason the watermark uses this, like a Pegel, I don't know the German word, the English word for this one. So, and here you see, with the fixed watermark, the latency increases, but therefore we have all the data inside, correctness is high. With the heuristic watermark, the latency is a little bit better because we have would be 1.5 seconds earlier, but we missed some data like this here and this here. So this is the first thing of when am I going to calculate my result. But think of a 1 hour window, or maybe a 6 hour window, and then I don't want to want my results only after 6 hours, but I want them in between maybe. And then there comes something into play that's called trigger, which actually just trigger the computation. And this might be time, this might be content again, this might be count again, that might be a the composite of all three. You recognize the pattern, it's not only time, it's also content and count. And time can be event time, can be processing time. So for example, we have a 1 hour window and I want to compute the result every 10 minutes after processing time, so at 1, 110, 120, 130. Then when the watermark is reached at the end of the window, then with each delayed event, but I only want to wait for like 15 more minutes and after this the data I don't care about. This is possible with when using trigger. But when I now have triggers, then I have a few single results. I have the results calculated at 1.10, I have the result calculated at 1.20, and so on. And that's the last step which now comes into play is the accumulators. What will I do with these single results? And also just take the example, we have been discarding way, an accumulating way, and an accumulating interdetectic way. So the discarding way just says, okay, I would just keep this small results and that's what I'm going to pass downstream for whatever processing or storing. We have the stream coming in, 5, 2, 8, 3, and 4, and the pipes here are the triggers, and the first trigger just says, okay, 7, 11, and 4. The accumulating says, okay, I will recognize what was the result before and just add it to the existing result. So we have the 7, and then 7 plus 8 is 18, and we have the 18 plus 4 is 22, and so on. And we have the accumulating and retracting, doing basically the same as the accumulating accumulator, but also say like, okay, this is the new value, but this was the old value, just apply this operation to roll back the old value. And now you might ask, okay, what I'm going to use, as often it depends. In this case, it depends on the downstream system. If you have an idempotent database you want to store the data inside, then it's totally fine to use the accumulating accumulator because you overwrite the old value most of the time. If you happen to send emails, for instance, emails, you cannot roll back emails. If an email has been sent, then it's sent. Then you most of the time won't send emails regarding from a streaming system, but then you would send use the discarding operator. So this is a little bit of theory. So we have watermarks and triggers to define when do we calculate, and then the accumulators to say how to aggregate those single results. And if we combine it in an API that might look like this, and this is actually pretty cool, I think. So we have a stream coming in. We do a fixed window of 10 minutes in this case, oh, 60 minutes, sorry. We're triggering at the watermark, not defining what watermark is. In this case, it would be a fixed watermark. With early firings every 10 minutes, so we after 10, 20, 40, and so on. And then at the watermark, with late firings every time a new event comes in. Then with an allowed lateness of 50 minutes, so we will wait for old events about 50 minutes long. And the single results will be handled as a discarding accumulator, so every result will be treated on its own. And what we're actually going to do is we do a sum per key. And I think this is a pretty nice way to express what I'm going to do with the stream. To be fair, that's not a complete API. If you use it in an API, the semantics are the same. Doesn't look that nice, that Polish, but the semantics are the same in Apache Beam and Google Cloud Dataflow. So this is the overall, I can handle everything in whatever kind of way I need it to, way to handle a stream. And then there's the stream and table model. And I will just give a sneak peek into the stream and table model because I'm pretty sure Tim will go into more detail because that's actually a model that Kafka Streams uses. And it basically says every entry in a stream can be used to, can be mapped to a table and the other way around. If a stream comes in, we have a key value could be represented in a table. Another value in the stream comes in, another value in the table. Another value in the stream, again for the key one, the table is just updated. And that's basically what the stream and table model is about. Events come in, every event updates the table and gives the result. But then, more on this, told you by Tim after the lunch. So this was time as a challenge. The other thing is stateful processing. And if you're not only doing like treat every event as it's on its own, which is most likely the most boring use case you can have in the streaming, which is fine for a start, but most of the time you will come to aggregations, you will have a state. You will have a state if you do window aggregations because the data which has been coming into the system must be buffered somewhere. You have a state that must be stored somewhere. Maybe for an hour if it's an hour window, maybe longer, maybe shorter, but you have a state. So a state is always like data coming in, you have some operation working with the state, maybe refreshing the state and giving an item back. It's pretty simple from a user perspective, but from a system perspective, from a framework perspective, it's quite interesting because the state implementation is a little bit tricky. You have to think about where do I store my state, especially if I'm in a distributed environment. What happens to the state if I rescale, if I add another node to the system? How do I make sure that state is the data is always sent to this node where the actual processing and the state is stored? I don't want to process the data on node A, but the state for this data is stored on node B. Then I always have the network traffic in between. So this is all the interesting stuff. Or if I refresh my application, if I build and extend my application, I have to deploy it again. The state might change. How can I reuse this state? So this is all the interesting stuff. I won't go into detail here. There are a few patterns which evolved. So most of the data streaming systems so far use RocksDB as a state store, which is lightweight key value store being developed by Facebook. Kafka Streams also uses then Kafka topic to be persistent. FlinkDB uses RocksDB. Spark, for instance, uses some magic own build stuff. I don't know. You can think of whatever you want. It works, that's fine. And especially Flink has a lot of things about how do you handle the rescaling of applications? How do you handle the some changes on the application code? This is the interesting stuff. So state is the first step if it comes to an environment. The next thing is where do I deploy my applications and where will it run? And we have mainly, if it comes to on-premise solutions like Spark, Flink, and Kafka Streams, not only on-premise, but could be on the cloud, but not as a platform. We have either the cluster manager solution. Those is Flink, this is Spark. So we have some application which we have written, which talks to a master node. This master node has some resources to offer and says the application here, you can run your code on this application, on this node, or in this node. And here you have some CPU shares and here you have some memory shares. The same is true for the Spark thing on a high level theme. And the other way is we just have a Java library and let it run wherever we want. Because, so this is all Java based, because we all maybe already have Java applications. So we maybe already have some container system where we run applications. It might be Kubernetes. It can also be like, hey, I just have a Java file and provision it to some host and start it, very dirty Java minus jar, and go. That might actually also be an application server. I wouldn't recommend it, but it would be possible. So this is a pretty lightweight thing, and this is the heavyweight thing. To be true, or to be honest, the lightweight thing sounds pretty good, but it only works because all of the hard tasks are done somewhere else, of course. For instance, the partitioning. This takes care of partitioning the data, partitioning the and scaling the data, scaling the application using multiple nodes. I don't have to care here because if you use, for instance, Kubernetes will do it for me. Or if you use DCUS, DCUS will support me in this one. Then there is a thing like partitioning the data will be done here. If you use the application only, it will be done some way. It's, for instance, if you use Kafka Streams, it will be done in Kafka. All the hard stuff is done in Kafka, which is fine. It has to be done somewhere. Why do it again here if I do it in Kafka again already? Another thing is the delivery guarantees. This once was a pretty interesting slide because there were differences. By now, it's mostly, so if you know the guarantees at most once, I guarantee you, you see it every event one time, maybe never. At least once you see every event at least once, but you might expect it, you should expect it that it might happen two or three times. And there's exactly once, I guarantee you, you see it once and once only and never twice and never, and you won't miss any event. This is pretty hard to achieve. This is quite good. And there's this quote from Victor Klang, one of the Akka contributors and maintainers. And this is actually a pretty good way to handle this, effectively once processing. So we have at least once guarantees, but I don't care how often the update or the event comes. The result will always be the same, meaning we have an idempotent operation. And if you're in a distributed environment, this is actually a pretty good way to handle this. If you try to use to build exactly once by yourself, most of the time that won't work. If you use solutions who offer exactly once, take a look into it, check if it's true. Most of the time they have some drawbacks. Most of the time they communicate it in a way that say, okay, we have give you exactly once semantics in this, and this case, but there might be some edge cases, and in this case we don't give you exactly one semantics, which is okay. You just have to think for yourself, is this fine for me? Are these edge cases true for me or not? Otherwise, I would always aim for at least once processing with idempotent operations. So those are some of the challenges. I already talked briefly about streaming frameworks which are available. So we have Apache Spark, which is not streaming, but some general batch processing and stream processing framework, having streaming, having batch processing. And this is the streaming. There is also the old Spark streaming, which doesn't have any event time support. So you don't have anything like late data or anything like this. It still doesn't exist. But they rewritten their streaming and use structured streaming right now. And they, you see, you have a watermark of 10 minutes, which is another wording for we wait for 10 minutes for old old data. Spark isn't completely aligned to the data flow model. They don't have to. You just have to know it. And this is also with Windows. And this is reading data from Kafka, processing in Spark. Then there's Apache Flink, actually a German project based in Berlin. While Spark was coming from, hey, we do batch processing, but everybody wants to do stream processing as well. Okay, just do very, very small batches, one after another, then call it streaming. That was Spark. And Flink was like, okay, we have a stream of data, and we treat it as a stream. And if we want to do batch, we say just, okay, the stream starts here and stops here. Then we have a batch. And they mainly focused on stream processing. The batch component of Flink is not that noteworthy, but the streaming component is pretty good, especially if you want all these fancy event time handling stuff. They're really good. And last but not least, there's the Kafka Streams API. Tim will tell you more about. So it's a library. There's no runtime environment compared to Spark and Flink. And they handle all the hard stuff. The partitioning, the scaling, the ordering, and all this stuff is done by Kafka, which is fine because I think in 90% of the use cases, Flink and Spark use Kafka as a source as well, the same as Kafka Streams. So some current developments we have right now. So one thing is the query array state. If I already have a state, if I do a window, I have a state which stores all my data. Why should I wait for the state to complete and the data should be written to the database? Why not query the state directly? And this is called the query able state, which is, in my opinion, a little bit better name. There's also the name of query direct, the name of interactive queries, but query state fits it pretty good what it is. And this is things working about. So it's working about in Kafka. It's in Flink. There's some things going on for this one. It's still a little bit low level. There's this thing with the data lifecycle. I mentioned it when we talked about state. What happens if I do rescaling? What happens if I do refresh my application code and so on? It's things like discovery on which node in a partition state do I have to query for get the actual data? It can all be solved, but it's still a little bit low level. And the second thing is the streaming SQL. On the right side, I think that was exactly the code Tim already had on the slide later in the previous talk. So streaming SQL is one thing. Kafka streams with KSQL is one, but also Flink has a SQL API for streaming right now. But there's a lot of things going on, a lot of discussions, and also the maintainers work together. So it's they see, okay, Flink does it like this way, this is interesting, okay, maybe we can do it this way and the other way around. So all those offerings are basically for I want to run it myself, either on premise or in an infrastructure in a cloud, but I want to run it myself. I have to run Kafka myself. There are cloud offerings. I have to deploy my Spark or Flink cluster, and I have to take care of this myself. And I want to just take a look into the cloud offers. So basically, AWS and the Google Cloud Platform. And if it comes to streaming in AWS, it's all about Kinesis. So if you ever hear about AWS Kinesis, it's going to be data streaming. They started with Kinesis, what is now called Kinesis Streams, which is from a high level way Kafka as a service. There are differences, but on a high-level thing, it's Kafka as a service. Then we have Kinesis Analytics, which does stream processing on data stored in Kinesis. And we have Kinesis Firehose, which stores data into databases, which is a little bit like Kafka Connect. From a high-level view, if you dig deeper, you see a lot of differences, but that's the overall mathematics. And we have AWS Lambda, which is the function as a service. So I just deploy my code over there, and AWS and the infrastructure takes care about it's going to be executed, where it's going to execute it, and the scale stuff. So the so-called serverless stuff. For me, it's more function as a service. And this can also be treated a little bit like stream processing, but we'll see it later. So streams, Kafka, it's a distributed log. It does scale automatically. It's good integrated in AWS. You can basically, it's one of the core services in AWS. You have to take care about partitioning. Same is true for Kafka. But there's some tricky things so streams uses sharding to scale. It shards all the data into multiple partitions. And for instance, every shard can be queried maximum 5 times a second. And if you want to get all the data from a stream, you have to query all shards. Meaning, you can query your stream for data 5 times a second. If you want to have 10 consumers on one stream, you can say every consumer can query the data for every 2 seconds. So here comes into play. If you have a low latency requirement, think about it. I don't say it's bad. It's just you just have to know about it. Sometimes AWS is pretty offensive with this information. Sometimes you have to dig very, very deep to get this information. It just depends. So then we have analytics. I will come to this a little bit later. Then Firehose stores the data in AWS managed data stores. You cannot run your own Cassandra over there and then say Firehose stored in Cassandra. Won't work. And there's Lambda, the function as a service, which can be used also to store data somewhere, but also for some pre-processing inside the stream processing. So Kinesis Data Analytics is SQL-based, completely SQL-based, and it can only take JSON and XML as an input. You can do some pre-processing with Lambda to get this data into your format if you don't have JSON or XML coming in, maybe Avro or whatever. The benefit of only allowing JSON and XML is it offers you automatic schema discovery. So you just say, this analytics application should consume this Kinesis stream. Find out the schema by yourself. Just take a look into the data. So in this case, we have this as a Vault thing, and he automatically discovers all the stuff. Not too magic. And this is what I talk about, the Lambda pre-processing. If your data isn't in CSV or in JSON or XML format by now, you can just consume the data, do all the unwrapping or deserializing of your data, and then pass it on as an XML or JSON. So that is the SQL code you actually write. They claim it's SQL. In my opinion, it's SQL-like. It looks like SQL, but I don't know if there's a pump in SQL or a stream in SQL. And so the basic idea is you create a stream, which is in this case the destination stream, which has 2 fields. This is really SQL-like. And then you create a pump, which inserts into the stream. And then you select a stream and from a source stream to actually do the analytics. This is pretty SQL-like as well, but you always have these destination stream pump. That's all this. It's all based around this stuff in AWS. This case, it's just building 10 seconds windows. This massive line is basically saying, okay, group it into 10 second windows, the incoming stream. What about processing and ingest in the event time in AWS? They say, of course, we can handle it. Also, again, if you dig a little bit deeper, they just give you all the information. You see the first window at 5:05, the second window 5:06, and we have in the 5:06 window event coming in at 5:05, so a little bit late event. And they say, hey, it's everything fine. You can detect it, but you have to take care about detecting that you have late data. It's not that they handle it for you. They don't buffer anything. They don't correct your results. And actually, this is combine the results in downstream database, meaning store both results in a database. And if you do the query, don't forget about, you have to query not only one bucket, but there might be data in other buckets too, which is, in my opinion, a little bit very low level compared to what all the data stream stuff is about. A few more things. So you can do data lookup if you need additional data, but only from S3 and only 1 gig. But there's some cool analytics function. Some people would call it machine learning and streaming. I'm pretty sure AWS does it at some point for marketing purposes, but it's basically a random forest and a little bit of hotbot detection, which is pretty cool built in. Gives you some nice examples you can build. You can only have one input stream per analytics application. Think about, you have a topic in Kafka, you would have a topic, clicks and views. If you do advertisement analytics, won't work in AWS. AWS streams are more centered about, I have one huge stream where all the data is in. And you can only have like three destination topics where AWS says, use one for awareness events you cannot process. So you basically have only two output streams. Might all be fine, you just have to know about it. So there are the subtle differences between Kafka and Kinesis, for instance. It gives you only at least once guarantees. You have to know that. That's fine from a performance perspective. And the last thing, if you want to use it in US Central, because we are German and we want to do it in Frankfurt, forget it. At least for the analytics CRUM. Kinesis, the streams, the Kafka replacement is available in Frankfurt as well, but the analytics stuff isn't. Then we have the decision on how to store data. There's Firehose, which lets you store data into S3, into Redshift, and into Splunk, but nothing else. So all the managed services by AWS. Pretty convenient. You just have to do some configuration, or you use Lambda and have to just implement it yourself. And that might be a little bit cheaper, actually. For both, it's true that we see the cost later on. I did some cost analytics. The cost heavily depends on event size. How much batching do you do there? Most of the time, all the services have a minimum event size which they will calculate with. So if we go about pricing, the stream stuff is priced using shards. How many shards? How much do I scale? And how much operations do I have in putting data inside the put operation? You can estimate this one pretty good if you know a little bit about your data volume you expect. Analytics is just, you rent a processing unit, and they might scale it to multiple processing units, and each processing unit has a fixed amount of CPU and RAM, and that's it. You have to experience by yourself how many processing units you actually need. It's pretty hard to calculate up front. Firehose itself is just based about throughput. Just take your event size, multiply it with a number of events, you get the throughput. Pretty easy. And we have Lambda. Cost for invocations, that's pretty good to estimate. And the cost for the runtime, how long does it run in the Lambda, also a little bit more tricky to calculate. I gave it a try. We have an example here for 10,000 events per second, and a pretty small event size of 200 bytes. You see the streaming here, the charts, it's not a really high volume stream. So the charts aren't expensive over a year. The puts are more expensive, but that might change. If you batch your events, for instance, then the puts will go down and will be a little bit cheaper. We have the analytics. I assume 10-minute window aggregation, so we have to store data for 10 minutes. Then 10 minutes in RAM. How many RAM do I need? plus some overhead. At the end, I assumed one unit will be sufficient. The firehose is actually pretty expensive for just taking data and store it. It doesn't anything else, just with some configuration. And with Lambda, that might be cheaper, but I assumed I batched the events. I assumed that the batches are pretty fast and don't use too much RAM. That might be completely changed, that you use a lot of RAM. The batches take long and then the total will go up. So around about $10,000 for a year of stream processing of a pretty low level stream with a continuous data. Just a small example. Just another look into the other, it's Google Cloud. So we have PubSub. PubSub is on a high level view. What is it? Again, like Kafka. And that's pretty much it, because there are very much differences underneath, more than with Kinesis. And we have Dataflow, which is the execution engine of your stream processing. And you can write it to multiple Google stuff. So Google Cloud Dataflow is actually, and I said that this is the Dataflow model. You remember the watermarks, triggers, and the stuff. This is actually implemented in Google Cloud Dataflow. So you have full flexibility. You don't write SQL, you write Java code or Python code, and you can do more or less whatever you want with it. Pretty much support on event time support. So all the good stuff the Dataflow stuff has, the Dataflow concept has, and also Flink has, is also true for Google. This is an example compared to what with SQL. You write your Java code or string code. In this case, it's a word count. I read data, split the words, count the words, and write it back to some output. Don't go too much into detail. The pricing. Google PubSub is priced purely on throughput. And throughput means writing data into it and getting data out of it. So writing costs. One application reading the data costs, another application reading the data costs again. And Dataflow is the same as with analytics. You have instances with compute power and how much you might ever need. Also some things. Same input, the PubSub is pretty expensive. We have published about 34 gigabytes, so it's not gigabyte, it's gigabyte with the 1,000 instead of 1,024. That's pretty expensive. The data flow itself, it's fine. It's not that much more expensive. But to be honest, this is mainly because the event size is so small. If the event size would be 5K, the price would be the same. Because they say the minimum event size we have is 5 kilobyte. So for the pricing, just the idea is be prepared to be surprised, and there's a lot of knobs to turn in if you go into a cloud environment if it comes to stream processing. So pricing comparison depends heavily on the parameters, especially size, how much data do you store actually. There are a lot of minimum prices, for instance, for PubSub at Firehose. The batching helps to reduce the costs. The raw processing units, so processing unit per hour, is a little bit cheaper on GCP, but it's not sure how they could be comparable. Is 4 gigabyte of RAM and one CPU really the same as in GCP as in AWS? And you can try yourself. I have some Google Calc sheet online, and you can find it here. Just try if you want and see how the prices changes. And just last word on stream processing versus serverless. Both can be triggered by a stream, either by PubSub or by Kinesis. But the difference is, in stream processing, you have all this stuff with windows. You have schema discovery. Streaming is less flexible for this, because if you do Lambda, for instance, you have Python, JavaScript, you can code whatever you want. but you have to code more, for instance, if you write data somewhere else or want to consume data. So it's serverless is pretty much low level, more flexible. Streaming is really focusing on doing stream analytics on data, all the events time stuff. So this is a difference here. So a lot of talk about, if you really think about, might streaming a choice for me? Might it be a choice for me? And when? What do I want to use for a framework? Really think about your requirements. What I'm actually going to achieve, because that makes a lot of difference in the end. First thing, what is about performance? How much performance and throughput do I actually need? Do I really need a cluster? Or is it totally fine to start with a small library and extend it, and this will be scalable as well? How much of the event time handling stuff do I actually need? Or is it, for me, there's no difference in event time. Is it for me, just event comes in whenever, and that's the way I handle it, because processing time is event time for me? Or do I really need all the stuff which a data flow model has? Or would be a middle thing like Kafka Streams totally work for me? What systems do I have to connect? Where do I have to write to? Do I need the complete flexibility? If I'm in the cloud, maybe, and I'm completely cloud native and I only write to S3, then maybe Firehose might be a thing. Otherwise, I have to take for Lambda. If I want to, if I'm in using Spark, Flink, or Kafka Streams, then I'm completely flexible most of the time where I want to write to. Another thing, who will actually implement the analytics? Will it be a programmer which is completely fluent in Java or Python? Or do you have this fancy idea of, hey, we have some people knowing the business, they can write SQL, so they should implement the stream? I'm a little bit skeptical by now with this, but that might be at some point a thing, depending on how SQL on streaming extends and how it's going to be make accessible for business people. Which language is preferred? SQL, do you really like want to write everything in SQL, which is pretty easy, but a little bit more low level? Java, Python, Scala. If you do Spark, for instance, I wouldn't go for Java too much because that's a little bit dirty. It feels pretty dirty. So if you don't like Scala, you will see a lot of Scala stack traces, so a lot of dollar signs, for those of you who have ever seen this. Which tools do you already have? Do you already have Kafka? So why shouldn't I use Kafka Streams, for instance? Why should I have another complex system like Spark next to Kafka? Or I already have a Hadoop suite in my house for something and use Spark on it, why not? Might be Spark Streaming totally fine for me, because operating all this stuff isn't that cheap. What about community? Do I need a? Would I prefer a project which is backed by a huge community? Would it be, or just say, hey, I'm fine with a good vendor. Do I maybe need licenses? Think about it. And all the stuff, the vendor doesn't only want your money because they want to give you support. Most of the time, the vendors have really cool stuff for monitoring. Do you really want to build monitoring by yourself? And monitoring Kafka and monitoring Kafka Streams, for instance, yeah, there's some JMX and there's some console thing, but most of the time, for a lot of companies, it's not their core business to monitor Kafka. Their core business is to do some business things, and that's the trade-off at the end. So maintaining monitoring, do I have the people to maintain and monitoring a complete cluster? Or maybe two clusters, Kafka and Spark? And what does it cost at the end? And maybe it's an idea just to run it in your execution environment where it's all managed in a cloud. Or you get Kafka as a service, which is also possible. Yeah, it costs something, but think about what does your engineer cost? What does your admin cost? What does licenses cost? What does hardware cost? So at the end, think of the total cost of ownership if you decide for the same thing, and don't see only, okay, that cost licenses and everything else we get. No, your people cost too. So for the takeaways, streaming is not easy. We have the event time things, we have state, we have the deployment stuff, we have the correctness, we have the connectivity to other systems, all the stuff. A lot of things you have to think about. But there are some concepts, some implementations which will help you. There's a lot of stuff going on. You have a broad thing of solutions that might be there, both on-prem and in the cloud. And be aware of monitoring these stuff. That's actually a pretty tricky part. And be aware of the overkill. Think about it. Do you really need a distributed scene processing for 500 events per second? I guess no. So that's it for me. I've just seen the pizza coming in. Perfect timing. But I'm still here for questions. So if you have any questions, just ask me now, later. I will be around. And then enjoy your lunch. So if you like this talk, I would really appreciate if you like the video. If you have any questions, just ask them in the comment. I will be happy to answer them. And if you want more information and keep on the topic, just subscribe to our YouTube channel.